Well, students, in this lecture, we are going to study an important concept called as X-ray diffraction. It is a very important analytical tool which is used to study the structure of a crystalline solid. Okay, so what is X-ray diffraction? First of all, what is diffraction? We know diffraction is the bending of light around the corner of an obstacle. Okay. But for diffraction to occur, there is a certain condition which needs to be satisfied. The condition is that the wavelength of the light and the size of the obstacle should be comparable, almost of the same size. Okay, so only if this condition is satisfied, then the ray bends, the light ray undergoes diffraction. Now, if we want to diffract X-rays, now remember, while discussing properties of X-rays, we saw that X-rays have a wavelength around 1 angstrom unit. Therefore, if you want to diffract or bend X-rays, then the obstacles which we use must be also of the size of around 1 angstrom unit. Okay, so only obstacles of the size around 1 angstrom unit will be able to diffract X-rays. Now the question is, what are these obstacles? What obstacles can we use to diffract X-rays? What obstacles are of the size of around 1 angstrom unit? Surely not the obstacles which we see around us, because remember, 1 angstrom unit is how small? It's 10 raised to minus 10 meters. It is invisible to the human eye. Okay, very, very small. So the obstacles also must be of the same size. So the obstacles which you see around us, like might be a table or human beings or even a dust particle for the matter, even a dust particle will be quite large compared to 1 angstrom unit. So even a dust particle will not be able to diffract X-rays. The size of a dust particle is around 1 micrometer, 10 raised to minus 6 meters, whereas X-rays have wavelength around 1 angstrom unit. So even a dust particle will not be able to diffract X-rays. So then which obstacle will be able to diffract X-rays? Now, we know that atoms in materials, there are in matter, in all matter there are atoms. The average size of an atom is around 1 angstrom unit. Okay, so it is only an atom which will be able to diffract or bend X-rays. So when we talk about X-ray diffraction, it is basically the obstacles which we are going to use are atoms in a material, in a solid material. Okay, so remember that thing. So wavelength of X-rays, 1 angstrom unit, and average size of atoms, most of the atoms are also of the size 1, 2, 3 angstrom units. Okay, so only atoms will be able to diffract X-rays. Now, next thing is diffraction grating. We know what is a diffraction grating. It is an arrangement of periodic, alternate, opaque and transparent regions. Now, what can work as a grating for X-rays? X-rays will be, a grating will have to have grating element approximately equal to 1 angstrom unit. Okay, so the only possible grating which we can use for X-rays is a crystalline solid. Okay, a crystalline solid. Because remember, in a crystalline solid, there are atoms which are periodically arranged. Amorphous solid have atoms which are randomly arranged. They don't have any periodicity. But in any crystalline solid, like a diamond, sodium chloride, or any other crystalline solid all metals are crystalline. Copper, aluminium, gold, all metals have a crystalline structure. Okay, so any crystalline solid, if you take, you will find an arrangement of atoms in it like this. So these are the atoms in a crystalline solid. The distance between them remains constant throughout the material. So this atoms in any crystalline solid can behave like a diffraction grating, this arrangement of atoms. Why? I told you, diffraction grating is an arrangement of alternate, periodic, opaque and transparent regions. So these atoms behave like opaque regions, and the space between the atoms behave like a transparent region. So opaque, transparent, opaque, transparent, opaque, transparent. So alternately and periodic, since the distance is remaining constant throughout, they are periodic. So alternate, opaque and transparent regions. So this arrangement of atoms in a crystalline solid can behave like a grating for X-rays, because the size of this obstacles here is of the size around 1 angstrom unit. So only atoms or only a crystalline solid can behave as a grating for X-rays. So such a diffraction, X-ray diffraction using a crystalline solid is X-ray diffraction, is called X-ray diffraction. Okay, such diffraction using a crystalline solid is called X-ray diffraction. So we're going to derive a very important law with respect to this X-ray diffraction. Okay, it's called as a Bragg's law. This is an important law in this chapter, just like Moseley's law. Another important law is the Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction. So let's see what this law, how we derive the formula for this law. So what we have in this figure here, this red, this black color dots which you see here, they are atoms, just like I've shown you in this figure here, atoms in a periodic atoms in a crystalline solid. So here also we have two planes of atoms. Mn is one plane of atoms and pq is another plane of atoms. So you remember, in a crystalline solid, just one layer of atoms are there, but there are different layers of atoms, first layer, second layer, third layer, as you go deeper inside the material. So we have considered here two layers of atomic planes, Mn and pq, and this black dots which you see here are the atoms which are periodic. Now the distance between the planes, plane 1 and plane 2, Mn and pq, is d. It's called as the interplanar distance. Okay, it's called as the interplanar distance, d, which is a constant for this set of planes in the crystalline solid. It's a constant because the atoms are periodically arranged. So d is a constant for a particular set of planes in the crystalline solid. Now what is falling on this crystalline solid, on this planes of atoms, is a parallel beam of X-rays, monochromatic X-rays having wavelength lambda. Okay, so ABC is one X-ray and DEF is another parallel X-ray. So both these X-rays are parallel to each other. AB and D are the incident X-rays, and BC and EF are the reflected X-rays reflected from the surface of the atomic planes in the crystalline solid. Now ABC is the ray which is reflected from the upper plane of atoms, Mn, and DEF is a X-ray which is reflected from the low plane of atoms. Remember, between the atoms there is a gap. So if this X-ray falls on this atom here, the other X-ray can pass between the gap and fall on the atom on the lower plane and get reflected from there. So ABC is reflected from the upper plane, DEF is reflected from the lower plane of atoms. Now we're going to find the path difference. Okay, we're going to find the path difference between these two rays, ABC and DEF. Now obviously you can see that which ray is traveling more distance is DEF, because it is traveling, going down and coming up, because ABC is reflected from the upper plane. So DEF is having more path, ABC is having less path. Now how much is the path difference? Now if you see from the starting point till this dotted line here, both the rays will travel the same distance, so no path difference. Similarly, from this dotted line onwards further, both the rays will travel the same distance. So whatever path difference is there is this much, GE plus EH. So GE plus EH is the extra distance the ray DEF is traveling compared to the ray ABC. So this is the path difference between the two rays. So the path difference delta, capital delta, is GE plus EH. Now in this figure, in this triangle BGE and BHE, these are both right angle triangles. Okay, both the triangles are congruent. Why are they congruent? Because two right angles here, these angles both are same. Now by the way, this angle at which the X-rays fall on the surface of the planes, atomic planes, is called as a glancing angle. Okay, glancing angle theta. Please note, it's not the angle of incidence, it's the glancing angle. It's the angle made by the X-rays with the atomic planes. So now this angle is theta. This side angle also is theta. Why? Because it's a reflection which is occurring. This is a reflected ray. So the both sides angles are theta. Now this angle here also is theta. Why? Because this angle here is 90 degrees. Okay, this ABG is 90 degrees and this is theta. So this angle here, MBG, angle MBG, is 90 minus theta. Now in this here, this angle MBE is 90. Angle MBE is 90. So therefore this angle GBE is 90 minus this angle. Angle GBE is 90 degrees minus this angle. And how much is this angle? This angle here is 90 minus theta. So therefore this angle will become 90 minus theta, which is theta. Okay, so we can prove that this angle here is theta. Similarly, this side angle also is theta, because this angle is theta. By the same logic, we can say that this angle here is also theta. So both these angles are same, two angles are 90 degrees, and this side is common. So by angle side angle, or by angle side, whatever rule you say, the two triangles, we can say they are congruent. So triangle BGE and triangle BHE are congruent. Now since they are congruent, we can therefore say that the distance GE is equal to EH. Okay, both these distances are same. So therefore path difference, which is GE plus EH, can be written as 2 times GE. Okay, because they are both equal to each other. So 2 times GE. Now what is the value of G? Now in this triangle here, in this triangle BGE, the right angle triangle, what is sine theta? Sine theta will be GE opposite side upon hypotenuse, which is BE. So GE upon B. So sine theta is GE upon B. But what is BE? BE is nothing but an interplanar distance, which is a constant D. Interplanar distance D. So BE is D. So we have sine theta is G upon B, which is G upon D. So what is G? Therefore, G will become D sine theta. D sine theta. Okay. So we substitute the value of G over here in this equation. So delta becomes 2D sine theta. So this is the expression for path difference between the ray ABC and the ray DEF. Now, these rays, after reflection of the crystals BC and EF, they will produce a maxima. They will, on interference, on meeting each other, will produce a maxima if this delta between them, the path difference between them, is m lambda. We know this, right? Condition for constructive interference maxima is that path difference between the rays must be an integral multiple of wavelength. Okay, so if delta is m lambda, these two rays on interference will produce a maxima. So therefore, for maxima, we can put that delta is equal to m lambda. So if you put this delta as m lambda in this equation 4, we will get the equation formula as 2d sine theta is equal to m lambda for maxima. Okay, so for maxima, the equation is 2d sine theta is equal to m lambda, where m can take integral values like 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. So this formula, 2d sine theta is equal to m lambda, is called the Bragg's law or the Bragg's equation of X-ray diffraction. Please note, it is basically a formula, it's an expression or equation for diffraction maxima, okay, because we have used the maxima condition. So Bragg's law is basically an equation which tells us the condition which will be satisfied for any maxima, diffraction maxima. Okay, so now, based on this Bragg's law, we can use this Bragg's law for an important application. Okay, it's to determine the interplanar distance d between these planes of atoms in the crystalline solid. Please note, you cannot take a microscope and observe these atoms or this interplanar distance because they are very small. No microscope will show you this. The only instrument which you can, only method by which you can find out this distance or interatomic distance and other things, is by using this technique called as X-ray diffraction. Okay, so if we know theta, if we can somehow measure theta, and if lambda is given to us, or and m also we measure, so if theta, m and lambda are known to us or given to us or measurable, then d can be calculated from the Bragg's formula. So this is an important application of Bragg's law, which we'll be seeing in the next lecture. The instrument is called as a Bragg spectrometer. So using the Bragg spectrometer, we are going to measure theta, lambda will be given to us. So theta and m we are going to measure using this Bragg spectrometer, and then using this Bragg's formula, we are going to find the interplanar distance D. So this is the application of Bragg's law, very, very important application, which you can find the interplanar distance of a crystalline solid. Thank you.